Let's praise our God.
Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood? In the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow?
Amen. Amen. Isn't that a good question? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? I'd like to welcome all those of you who are online, who are joining us on this long weekend. It seems like a lot of people have taken this long weekend, and it's a good opportunity to enjoy God's wonderful creation and just enjoy what He's done for us in every way. And this morning, of course, is Communion Sunday. So as we join together this morning, let's just open in prayer. Father, we just thank You that You have given us the opportunity to participate with You in all the goodness that You've made available to us. And it astounds us, Father, that You would call us to be Your own. But here we are, a grateful people, a humble people, looking to You for Your wonderful blessing, looking for Your wonderful Holy Spirit to do in us those things that we cannot do. Lord, we just want that transformation that comes by Your love over us. We ask Your blessing over all those who hear the word this day, that they would hear the word not only in their ears, Father, but in their spirit man, and there would become revival happening in the lives of each one of us. And we praise You this morning in that precious name, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Welcome, welcome. Good to see you all here that we're able to make it this morning. Be blessed this morning as Liz leads us.
We serve an amazing God, don't we?
Amen.
Oh, He's so amazing. Your love is amazing, steady and unchanging. Your love is a mountain from beneath my feet. Your love is a mystery, how You gently lift me when I am surrounded. Your love carries me. Makes me sing, hallelujah, hallelujah.
surprising. I can feel it rising. All the joy that's growing deep inside of me. Every time I see you, all your goodness shines through. I can feel this God song rising up in me. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing. 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 Your love makes me sing. Praise is rising. Eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. We long for you, 'cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. We turn to you. In your kingdom, broken lives are made new. You make us new. It's when we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna, come out. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away. Yes, Lord. 'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away.
Hosanna, Hosanna, come.
today and what you are doing in our lives. Thank you, Jesus.
Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I
was once lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see.
It was grace
that taught my heart to feel, and grace my fears relieved. How precious dear that grace appeared, the hour I first believed. My chains are on, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy
has promised good to me. His word, my hope secures.
He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. My chains
He is forever ours. He has given himself for us. And we are a blessed people this morning. Thank you. Thank you, people. Young guy, And we all started out young someplace along the way. And I mean from probably a really young child till I was about 10 or 12 years old, I spent a lot of time with my great-grandmother. And she was really good to me, and I really loved my great-grandmother. But what twigged me this morning was I titled this message, The Lord's Table, because I was always, and still am, if you ask my wife, a fidgety individual. I never seem to be able to sit still. And my grandmother would say to me, now, you be still at the dinner table. You be still. This is the Lord's table. She had a real reverence for sitting down together and joining together in fellowship, a thought of coming together. And then this was the Lord's table. You didn't fiddle around, and you were quiet, and you showed reverence. So that's what made me title this message, what I did. On a normal Sunday morning, Communion Sunday, before COVID, we would have the communion set up here on the front table and we would serve it. But what does the word communion mean to us? We do church, we come together, and in different places they call it by different names. We happen to call it communion, Lord's table, Lord's supper, and all sorts of different names. To have sweet communion. The thesaurus gives us these words: unity, empathy, close association, relationship, and spiritual union. All of these give us some facts, but there's a bigger picture here. Bigger picture where we actually join together. We become united and experience life together. That's what community, that's what the church body is all about. Staying in fellowship, being part of the fellowship. To sit down at a meal together, to eat the same food, to share our stories together, some true, some not true, so true maybe, and to experience life together. That's what communion's all about. And so when Jesus calls us to join together with him, he's saying more than just, you know about it. It's to join in with him. And when John the Baptist said and pointed to Jesus, "Behold the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world," those who heard him should have understood what he was saying. They all knew about the sacrificial lamb taken at Passover, how God had told them to take the lamb from either the sheep or the goats and to pen it up for 3 days, and on the 14th day of the month to sacrifice it and put the blood of the lamb on the doorposts, if you remember, and on the lintel of the door, and that they were to stay inside of this house until the death angel passed by. Now, that's a really good message for all of us. We need to stay in fellowship. We need to stay in the house. We need to stay under the covering of Christ. We need to keep that on the top of our hearts. And as the angel of death passed by, of course, he struck the firstborn of the Egyptians. And this was part of their life, that over and over and over they did this. But the Lord had said to them in Exodus 12, actually, I just gave the computer 12, 13, but I'm going to read 12 and 13. "For I will pass through the land of Egypt on that night, and I will strike the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast, and against all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgment. I am the Lord. Now the blood shall be a sign for you on your houses where you are, and when you see the blood," or when I see the blood, sorry, "I will pass over you, and the plague shall not be on you to destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt." So here we are this morning, taking refuge. God had chosen to set Israel apart, to set them out as an example, as it were. Not because of their righteousness, not because of your righteousness that Christ has called you, not because of that, but because he had made a promise to Abraham. And why did he promise Abraham? Why did he make a promise to Abraham? He made a promise to Abraham Because Abraham believed him, believed God. When God had said to him, Abraham, I will do thus and so, and if you read the piece in Genesis 15 or even farther, you'll find where God made a lot of promises to Abraham. But where it says he believed God, that's where it hinges, brothers and sisters. It hinges on believing God. And when the Apostle Paul writes his letters to the churches, he quotes a piece out of Habakkuk, however you like to say it, four different places as he writes to the churches. And in Galatians 3:11, this is one I just picked up for a quote for you, but that no one is justified by the law in the sight of God is evident for what? The just shall live by faith. And he uses that passage more than once to emphasize that it's not about keeping the rules. It's not about all of those things. It's always been about believing God, even from the beginning. Adam didn't believe God. Got himself in trouble. Noah believed God, built an ark. Abraham believed God, and God gave him righteousness. This was a new beginning for them, for the Israelites, as they came out of Egypt. It was a new beginning for them. It was a new year for them, and a new life for them. I mean, all those are pictures for us to see that what Jesus has done for us. Not only is it a new beginning, new birth, as we call it, but it's a beginning to step into God's will, to stay in the faith. Christ always offers us. So that it should have been clear to them when what John was saying, but Isaiah's prophecy comes true in them in Isaiah 6, 9 through, what do I got here, 6 through 10. And he said, go to tell his people. Keep on hearing, but you do not understand. Keep on seeing, but do not perceive. Make the heart of this people dull and the ears heavy. Shut their eyes, lest they see with their eyes, hear with their ears, and understand with their heart, and turn and be healed. The Apostle Paul tells us in Romans 11 that all of this happened for a purpose, to include the Gentiles, or you and I, into God's plan, into God's plan of redemption. This is a new covenant. Jesus says, new covenant. That means the old has passed away. It has lost its power, has lost its value. As we read through the passage in Luke at the Last Supper, we see that there is no mistake here. Jesus clearly says, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you. Luke 22, starting at 14. And when the hour had come, he sat down and with the 12 apostles, and he said to them, with fervent desire I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say to you, I will no longer eat of it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. And then he took the cup and gave thanks and said, take this and divide it among yourselves. For I say to you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. And he took the bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to them, saying, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Likewise, he took the cup after supper, saying, this is the cup, is the new covenant, in my blood, which is shed for you. As the Apostle Paul writes to the Gentile church, he's including the Gentiles in all of these promises because he saw the plan of God unfolding. To the Gentile church in Ephesians, he makes it clear that the plan of God was to reach to all men. And this has always been the plan of God. We often find the phrase, the mystery of the gospel. As you read through especially the letters, he speaks of the mystery of the gospel. Well, this is the mystery, brothers and sisters. Everybody's included. It was always God's plan to include everyone. In Ephesians chapter 1, we find phrases like, he blessed us, he chose us, he predestined us. according to the goodwill of his pleasure and his will. He made us acceptable. In him we have redemption through his blood. He made to abound, that is to overflow toward us, that he might gather together in one all things in Christ Jesus. Always was the plan to gather it all together in Christ Jesus, because Christ Jesus is eternal. In him we have obtained an inheritance, and according to his counsel of his will. Now, my friends, that's what we call being invited home for dinner. Jesus is inviting us to dinner, to join together over the same meal, to have the same fellowship together with one another. Jesus is asking us home for the meal, to join with him in his life, to experience him, to experience life more abundant, to have his life, which is the eternal life. Jesus came with the authority of the Father to purchase back that which had been lost. If you've seen the movie The Passion of Christ, how every time I've seen it, and I've only seen it a couple times, and I'd rather not see it over and over again, truthfully, somehow I don't really believe it tells the whole story. It doesn't. Yes, it's graphic as can be, but there was a lot of anguish that was happening in the heart of Christ, I believe, that cannot be depicted really, but we see there was a lot of suffering. In the depictions, as we see artists make that depiction, oftentimes we see it kind of whitewashed. But it's important for us to see that it wasn't fun for him. Matthew 26 gives us this phrase, "My soul is sorrowful even unto death." And he fell on his face and prayed. Have you ever been in that place where in your life where you just felt so weak, you just would be just overcome by what was happening? Well, that's what was happening for him. He was experiencing that anguish of soul, that struggle that was happening. And he was doing it for us. Father, if it were possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but you will, as you will. It's important to see the obedience here. It's important for us to see that he calls us to an obedience, that to overcome the old man, the old person. And that's what he was doing for us. Luke gives us a detail here. Being in agony, he prayed more earnestly when his sweat became like drops of blood falling to the ground. Jesus saw it coming, yet he went on because he was fulfilling Scripture. The Apostle Paul quotes Psalm 14 for us in Romans 3, 10 through 12. It reads like this, "There is none righteous, no, not one. There is none who understands, there is none who seeks after God. They have all turned aside, they have altogether become unprofitable. There is none who does good, no, not one. But now, brothers and sisters," oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, "there is one who is righteous, there is one who understands, there is one who has not turned aside, and there is one who is good and profitable." And who is that? Jesus. He broke all of those bondages. Jesus knew that he was going to be able to say in Revelation, as he reveals himself to John, "I am he who lives and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. And I have the keys of death and hell." He's taken the keys of hell and death from the grip of the accuser. He took the trump card from his hand. As Paul sorts through the beginning of Romans, and if you read through the first seven chapters of Romans, you can see the struggles and the theology he's building for us. But then it comes to Romans 8, and he says, therefore, there is no condemnation in Christ Jesus. It's so important for us to see that as we present the message of the gospel. Jesus didn't come to bring condemnation. Jesus came to bring us release from those things that the enemy, the accuser, actually he's called the devil, is called the accuser because he accuses the brethren. Now there's no place for condemnation. There's no place for accusation as we come under the covering of Christ and we repent of our sin and we ask that his Holy Spirit do a work in our lives, that we come together with him and join with him. He sets that all aside, washes it away, so the enemy cannot come and say, no, can't do that anymore, because Jesus dealt with that. He saw us here today. He saw us here today confessing our faith in him alone, him alone, as our freedom from that condemnation. The power of his Holy Spirit to transform and set prisoners free. But prisoners, my chains are gone. We sang that this morning as Liz led us. The chain that brought condemnation, brought accusation on us, was broken in Christ. And if as we begin to step into that, we begin to experience that freedom, that freedom that only that Holy Spirit working in us can bring about us. In Romans 16:20, it says this, and the God of peace will crush Satan under your feet shortly. Ephesians 2:4, but God, who is rich in mercy, because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, he made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up together, and made us to sit together in where? Heavenly places. Hallelujah. In Christ Jesus. That in the ages to come, he might show his exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. God wants to boast about us. He's going to, in the ages to come, he wants to be able to say, see the work that was accomplished. It's my work. It's my plan, my blood, my life given. These are the fruit of these things that happened because of his great, great kindness. Doesn't it astound you? As I explore the gospel and God has given me grace over 40-some years to explore the word and explore the gospel, I am still astounded. Because when I look in the mirror, I know who I am. I know who I was. And I know some of the things that I even yet deal with. And I am astounded that he would love me. And it's important for us to walk in that place of humility, to understand that it is by grace we have been saved, not of ourselves. Amen. That you and I, think about it, that you and I would be included in God's plans for eternity. Not about this life, brothers and sisters. This life passes away. He's included. He's called us, if you like. The voice of the Spirit is calling to all who will receive the message of life in Christ to come and join me in eternity. Come and join me with everlasting. Come and join me. Life more abundant. Not this life. His life. The people of Jesus' day understood how sacrifice worked. They understood that to take part in the sacrificial offering was to take part in the strength and the life and the wisdom and the power of the God that they were worshiping, whatever that God might have been. They understood that sort of thing. To eat the sacrifice was to eat the same food as that God. To drink the same libation was to join together, to take into themselves the drink of that God. And so participate in the strength of that God. When Jesus introduces the idea of covenant relationship with God, through participating in his body and blood, they should have understood. But when you read the passage where he actually enters into and says to them, unless you eat my body and drink my blood, you have no part of me, the word says many turned away. They just couldn't grasp that. And even turns to the disciples and said, well, will you guys leave me as well? And what's Peter say? Lord, you alone have the words of life. It's not just enough to follow his teachings. We must participate. We must participate in that life. He is to our spirit like bread is to the body. And we eat every day, all of us, maybe a little more than we should. Be fat in the spirit rather than in the flesh. The communion table is an invitation from God himself to come and participate in his life, his strength. The writer of Hebrews alludes to this in Hebrews 2, 14 and 15. He says, inasmuch as the children, that's us, have taken part of flesh and blood, he himself, that is Jesus, likewise shared in the same, that through death he might, what? Destroy him who had the power of death, that is the devil. And to release, get it again, understand the freedom, to release those who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. For indeed he does not give aid to angels, but he does give aid to the seed of Abraham, that is, those who are of faith. Spells it out more clearly for us when he says to us that through the promises of God we actually participate in God's eternal nature. 2 Peter chapter 1 verses 1 through 4 or 2 through 4. Grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, verse 3, as his divine power has given us all things pertaining to life and godliness, through the knowledge of him who called us by glory and virtue, verse 4, by which he has given us exceeding great and precious promises, that, listen now, through these you may, what, be partakers of what? The divine nature. The divine nature is the eternal nature, having escaped the corruption, that is death, that is in this world through lust. Escape death. Yes, we'll all physically pass on. Jesus said, even those who die shall live. See what Peter says to us in verse 2. The divine power has given to us all things pertaining to life and godliness through the knowledge of him. It's in knowing him. It's in participating with knowing him who calls us to glory and virtue. What does that mean to us? It means that just what it says. God has called us to participate in his life. Not only in the eternal, but in all that comes with joining him. As you look up into the night sky and the astronomers are looking farther than we've ever looked before, and the imagination of God, when you look around, Pastor Benny was away fishing and got fish, and think about all the different kinds of fish or insects. I have often been taken by the infinite imagination of God. Can you imagine, brothers and sisters, participating in that, being, having that kind of vastness of understanding and knowledge? Because he calls us to that. Living in the eternal, but he calls us to join him. He is calling us to an obedience to his way and not the world's way. Jesus' obedience to the Father will... Father's will all the way to the cross brought for those who will believe victory in every situation. As we take part in the communion this morning, may each of us have a new awareness of what it means to be victorious in every situation through our Savior, Jesus Christ. As Paul attempts to bring some focus to the Corinthian church, he says to them in 2 Corinthians 4, and since we have the same spirit of faith, according to what is written. I believed, therefore I spoke. We also believe, and therefore we speak, knowing that he who raised up the Lord Jesus will also raise us up with Jesus and will present us with you. For all things are for your sake, that grace, having spread through many, may cause thanksgiving to abound to the glory of God. Therefore, do not lose heart. We've all been through some trials, and maybe even yet to come. Do not lose heart, even though our outward man is perishing, yet the inward man is being renewed day by day. That's participating with. For our, what kind of affliction? Light affliction, which is but for a moment, is working for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. Now get this. While we do not look at the things which are seen, but the things which are unseen. For the things which are seen are what? Temporary. We have to have that eternal view in our hearts. We've got to be able to see beyond this. They're temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal. Now, just a simple question, which would you rather have, the temporary or the eternal? Things that are totally worn out very quickly, or God's eternal purposes? Liz. We have been invited home for dinner. This morning we'll experience the appetizer, if you like. But the main course, brothers and sisters, the main course is the marriage supper of the Lamb. Don't miss it. Don't miss it. Holy Spirit continues to call and to call and to call and to generate and to generate and to look for those who will say, yes, Lord, I believe. I don't understand a lot of things, Lord. I don't understand what's going on. I don't understand this anguish that I'm experiencing. I don't understand the trials of life. But I believe, Lord, that you got a good plan and you're going to work that good plan out in my life, even if it is into eternity, because he loves you. He loves you. He loves you even to the point of death. Don't miss it. The marriage supper of the Lamb. Amen. Consuming fire.
hallelujah, Jesus. Let's just take this moment just to think about what has been said to us, the word that has been preached, the scriptures that have been read. Just, Lord, just reminding us of what Jesus did for us on the cross, the price that he's paid for us, that we might have life and eternal life. Hallelujah. We're so thankful, Jesus. We're so thankful, Jesus. We're thankful for your love. We're so thankful for your grace, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. We're so thankful. We're so thankful for the day that you came into our life and saved us and transformed us from the inside out. We're so thankful for that, Lord. We're so thankful for the freedom that we enjoy, freedom from sin and bondage, Lord. When you came into our lives and set us free, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. I'm going to read some scripture from 1 Corinthians chapter 11 just before we participate in communion. And hopefully you picked up communion emblems as you came in this morning. Of course, the emblems, you pull the tape at the top and you get your wafer. And then the second layer, you get into your juice, just preparing you. Those of you that may not have had these cups before, have used these emblems before. For those of you online, you're on your own. Hopefully you're prepared, have your communion emblems ready. I was thinking as Pastor Ed was preaching, thank you, Pastor Ed, for sharing the word this morning. I was thinking as he was sharing those scriptures, just really talking about Jesus and what he did and in preparation for that last communion before he gave his life for us. Really, the Apostle Paul picks up on that in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, because when Jesus was walking in the flesh on earth, Paul was doing his own thing. But later on, Paul found Jesus, was converted, and he says these words, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed," which we read about, "took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me.' For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. And so a man ought to examine himself before he eats of the bread and drinks of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without recognizing the body of the Lord eats and drinks judgment on himself. That is why many among you are weak and sick, and a number of you have fallen asleep. But if we judged ourselves, we would not come under judgment. But when we are judged by the Lord, we are being disciplined so that we will not be condemned with the world." And so kind of as I read the scripture verses, we've read it different times, really, Paul wants us to look back, which we heard about today, look back to the cross. We want to be reminded of Jesus' death on the cross. Never lose sight of the cross. Never lose sight of what Jesus did for us. That's what the pastor's done this morning. And he's really encouraging us to look within, really. Examine ourselves. And so I would encourage you this morning not only to think about the cross, but to think about your own life and think about your spiritual condition. Think about your heart. Make sure your heart is always clean. Make sure your heart is always pure. So we look back, we look within, and we look forward. He talks about forward too. We look forward to the day when we gather with all the saints throughout history and participate in the great communion with Jesus around the throne. And so let's just pray before we participate in these emblems. Thank you, Jesus, once again. Thank you for giving your life. Thank you for your precious blood that was shed for us. Without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sins. We thank you for that, Jesus. We thank you that even this morning, as we confess our sins, you're faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us and wash us. And so, Lord, how important it is for us to look within our hearts today, and if there's things in our lives that are not right, that we'd confess those sins and allow your precious blood to cleanse us, to wash us, to make us whole. And Lord, in doing that, Lord, we also look forward to the day when we will be together with you and we will see you. We will see your nail-scarred hands. We will gather saints throughout the history and celebrate the Lamb, celebrate what you've done for us. We thank you, Lord, for this precious blood. We thank you for giving your life for us. We pray these things in your precious and wonderful name. Amen. And so as I read for you, the Lord Jesus, the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's participate of the wafer. Thank you for your broken body. We thank you, Lord, as the scripture said, without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sin. It also says, by your stripes, we are healed. So we stand on that today. We just know that you're a healing God, able to touch and minister, even in this moment, we pray. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me." And so let's participate in the cup. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm going to invite you to stand with me, and we're going to sing a song. I'm just going to give you a chance just to worship the Lord. You know, folks, I have to confess to you that, you know, you do ministry, you give out, you're involved always in giving out. Thelma and I went to Spring Bay Camp for a week. We were away for a week, and thank you for the leadership that looked after the church while we were away. I don't know whether you don't realize how dry you are inside and how you need God to fill you to overflowing. Until you're sitting there and you're not involved in ministry, you're not preaching. Every Sunday morning, Sunday night, actually I got a lawn chair set just outside the tabernacle. And I felt like this past week, I was just like a sponge, just drinking in. It's just what I needed, and Thelma needed. You know, folks, we need to stop sometimes and say, "God, fill me to overflowing. Minister to my heart. Pour into my life." And I encourage you, as we sing this song and we're going to close in a minute, just say, "God, come and minister by the power of your Spirit. Come on, pour out your Spirit. Consuming fire, fan into flame, work in my life. Fill me to overflowing," as we sing this song together.
He became sin who knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself and he carried the cross. Love so amazing. Love so amazing. Jesus, Messiah. Rescue for sinners. His body the bread, His blood the wine, broken and poured out all for love. The whole earth trembled and the veil was torn. Love so Jesus, Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sin. Jesus, Messiah, Lord of all our hope is in you, all our hope is in you, all the Jesus, Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sin. Jesus, Messiah, Lord of all. Jesus, Messiah, Lord of all.
Just worship the Lord this morning. Just come like a sponge. Just say, God, I need you. I need you. Minister to my heart. Pour into my spirit, your very spirit. Renew me, change me, transform me. Hallelujah, Jesus. We're going to sing that song in just a minute as we close and we say goodbye to our online audience and we dismiss you, of course. I just want to mention, thank you, folks, for being so faithful to the Lord throughout this last year and a half, throughout the summer, being faithful, coming to church. Thank you for your giving. Thank you for your faithful giving. And of those of you that want to know how to give, you just placed your offering in the offering plates. And online, many of you are giving online through our e-transfer. So thank you for your faithfulness throughout this time. Of course, we have mentioned that We do a live Facebook service. We do post our services on Elam Church Online for those that aren't able to come through Facebook. So there are services on our you'd find on our website, and so they're there for you. I want to thank Pastor Ed for giving leadership. Thank you, Liz, for your worship, leading in worship. It's just been great to know that the church is in good hands. Good to come back this Sunday and just to be able to enjoy the presence of God. We're going to sing this song one more time, and that will be the dismissal song. Just worship the Lord. Those of you that are in line, this will be the goodbye. Just worship the Lord. Just take this time. Don't rush away from the presence of God. He wants to minister. He wants to do something special in your life. Just allow the Lord to do what He wants to do as we sing this again. Great song.
He became sin, who knew no sin, that we might become His righteousness. He humbled Himself, and He carried the cross. Love so amazing. Love so amazing. Jesus Messiah. Name of
for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all, Jesus Messiah.
Hallelujah. Lord, as we leave this place this morning, we don't leave your presence because you're here and you live in us. We thank you for your presence here this morning, ministering to our hearts and lives as we go from this place, and those that are online leave and are involved in their activities throughout the day. Oh, that your sweet presence would go with us, and may we recognize your presence, and may we draw from your presence throughout this week. Thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for being with us today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you.